name liveth forevermore.
Switch on to the new series of Video Diaries and meet the drug-busting detective of Chester PD Blue.
I like being sneaky in my job settings.
Meet Steve and Sue. They're pretty blue too.
We can't have our own family. We can't have our own baby.
I'm just a complete failure.
Whereas...
I'm intelligent. I'm a genius.
Ha! But can these South African counsellors help heal the wounds of apartheid? And just how do you find a suitable boy?
No one's considering my feelings. It's a day.
Make a date in your diary for Video Diaries in half an hour on BBC Two.
Making tracks for Foreign Climes now on BBC Two, the travel show.
Hello. Whether you enjoy working up a healthy appetite on holiday or indulging it on fine food, tonight's travel show caters for every taste. Master gourmet Lloyd Grossman visits Lyon, the city at the heart of the French obsession with food. Intrepid reporter Simon Calder pedals in low gear through southwest Scotland. And travel writer Sophie Campbell hoofs it with the dairy herds in the alpine meadows around Kandersteg in Switzerland. Lyon may be France's second city, but when it comes to the national obsession, it's unrivaled. Food is so important, it seems to govern the whole Lyonnais way of life. So it's not surprising that this should be the favourite French city of gastronome Lloyd Grossman. He invited the travel show to join him on one of his regular culinary visits to this grand but often overlooked city in the heart of France. Lyon lies in the Rhône Valley and is considered the gateway to the south of France and a halfway stage on the Paris to Marseille motorway. Lloyd began his tour in the old quarter, Vieux Lyon, before moving on to the tongue of land known as the Presque Isle, between the Rhône and the smaller Saône River, which is the smart commercial centre of the city. Lloyd started his day by joining the Lyonnais for some early morning shopping.
For many travellers, Lyon is a bore. It's where they get stuck in traffic on the way to the south of France. Well, silly them, because they're missing a city full of culture and swank. Next week, this place will be hosting the G7 world leaders, intent on two things, global economics and a good nosh. Now, even by French standards, the inhabitants of Lyon are excessively devoted to their stomachs. At last count, there were 1,523 restaurants in town. And wherever you look, there are markets that are positively bulging with the Gallic fat of the land. One of the best markets is here at Quai Saint-Antoine, where the raw materials of the whole Lyonnais menu are laid out before you. Pierre Orsi is one of the top local chefs who'll be preparing a feast for the G7 leaders. He's a great Lyonnais food guide.
See, this tomato is really firm, fresh. We can make a lot of fresh coulis.
You're going to be cooking for Bill Clinton, Jacques Chirac, John Major. What are you going to cook for them?
I think we want to make the cooking only with the produce close to Lyon, like beef charolais, like veal, like pigeon, and like pike for making quenelle of brochet, specifically from Lyon, cooking.
The hill that rises above the Saône River harbours the old town of Lyon and rivals Venice for its dense population of Renaissance buildings. As well as getting your fix of 15th century living, there's also the opportunity to play detective here, for behind certain doors lie every Cluedo player's dream, a series of secret passages. They're called Traboul, and they run Warren-like through private courtyards and hallways. No one knows why they were first built, but they sure came in handy to transport silk in bad weather. Lyon's full of establishments called Bouchon. They're neighborhood restaurants, they serve very earthy food and plenty of wine, and they look just like this, only they're usually a little bit bigger. I followed my nose to Les Trois Maris, a Bouchon run in the immemorial family tradition. Cyril, tell me, what is it about Lyonnais food that's different from other French food?
I guess we tend to use all the regional products, like, and we're also influenced by Italian cooking from the north. And I think we don't compromise with fashion, and we stick to the old stuff. That's what we do.
No animal part is safe from the steel knives of Cyril and his father Jacques. From salamis to truffle-injected sausages to every cut of charcuterie known to man, jellied heads, breaded ears, and tails. It's a vegetarian hell, but if you're a meat eater, you might as well take the plunge and try a tripe sausage.
Bon appétit, monsieur.
Merci.
Alas, not quite my favorite. Not far away is the Tour Rose. It's a small hotel where every room is a floor-to-ceiling tribute to the fabric that made Lyon rich, silk. A sausage throw across the river is the 18th century Presqu'île district. The stately squares and wide boulevards have all the chic of Paris without the attitude. Here, there's always time to shop. It was a great opportunity to add just one more Hermès silk tie to my wardrobe. It was time to head for dinner, destination Pierre Orsi's restaurant. It's a self-styled maison bourgeoise, a fortified mansion of haute cuisine. Well, here it is. It's got a wonderful, highly perfumed smell. It's very, very beautiful. It's the product of a lot of hard work and a passion for the good life. So in that respect, it's very typical of Lyon. And it tastes wonderful. So at least for a few days, the most powerful people in the world are also going to be the best fed when they come here to Lyon.
Just 2.5 hours by train from Paris or the south, Lyon can be reached in time for lunch from most French holiday centres. The only direct flights to Lyon from the UK depart from Heathrow, and Air France have the most regular service, with fares starting at around £140. At the elegant La Tour Rose, a silk-lined double room will cost around £120 per night. A four-course dinner at Pierre Orsi's restaurant will cost about £40. But Bouchon bistros such as Les Trois Maris offer a cheaper dinner option at around £12.50 a head, a good antidote to the strong franc. The mere mention of cycle touring can strike fear in the hearts of all but the out-and-out enthusiast. But it doesn't have to be all heads down and hard slog. Britain's new national cycle network is helping to promote the leisure aspects of pedal power, with carefully planned routes across some of the most beautiful areas of Britain. Our regular reporter Simon Calder took to the saddle to try out one stretch of the new route. His choice, Dumfries to Glasgow, took him through some of the least known and least hilly parts of Scotland. Simon's journey took him through southwestern Scotland and the counties of Dumfries and Galloway and Ayrshire. The winding 189-mile stretch of the national cycle route from Carlisle to Glasgow follows quiet country roads and traffic-free forest trails. Simon joined it at Dumfries and headed through Glentrul towards Culzean Castle. Then it was on into Burns country and the west coast town of Alloway before the final leg of the journey into Glasgow. Simon's first challenge was getting his bike to the start of the route in Dumfries.
Cycling holidays may sound like hard work, but the real slog comes before you start pedalling. Travelling with a bicycle can be a real headache, and on trains, bikes need tickets too. Luckily, mine's travelling incognito.
The trouble with most folding bikes is they tend to be more Toys R Us than Tour de France, so I'm hoping this new detachable design will help me cover the ground without me or the bike folding. Why do boys always think they can do these things without looking at the instruction booklet?
The great thing about the climate in this part of Britain is that if you don't like it, just stay overnight. It's bound to look different when you wake up. With only the handlebars between you and the view, you can not only see Scotland close up, but smell it as well. This area was the Scots front line in the days of William Wallace, alias Braveheart, and Robert the Bruce, and it's strewn with crumbling memorials to the conflict with England. Another castle, but a different chapter in Scotland's history. This is the Scottish Cycle Museum, just a few miles from the spot where, in 1842, Kirkpatrick Macmillan put pedals on a cycle and made the first ever long-distance bike ride from here to Glasgow. The place is piled high with the ancestors of my thoroughly modern bike, and if you ask very nicely and are feeling brave, the curator may let you have a go. After that, I really do feel like the king of the road on my mean machine. Well, almost. The national cycle route takes you through villages with plenty of places to rest and recuperate. But I've got something grander in mind. This is Culzean Castle, designed 200 years ago by Robert Adam, and now the Scottish National Trust's biggest crowd puller. But day trippers aren't allowed upstairs, so they miss out on the presidential suite.
In 1945, the American general Dwight Eisenhower was given part of the castle as a reward for his war service. He later became American president and used the apartment as a retreat from the White House. It's now a holiday home for anyone able to afford £300 a night.
If you stayed here too long, you could completely go off the idea of cycling an inch further. As Eisenhower said, this is somewhere I can really relax. Red sky at night, cyclists' delight. But not in Ayrshire. My favourite stretches of the cycle network are the ones that take you away from the traffic onto forest trails like this one at Loch Troon. When you're soaking wet, it can't hurt stopping just a little longer. The great poet Robert Burns was born here in Alloway, and any visitor this summer will find it hard to avoid the Burns Bonanza marking the bicentenary of his death. Effie Campbell was Ayrshire's first female minister of the Church of Scotland. She sings the praises of Burns despite his wayward behaviour.
Now, Effie, I think it's true to say that Robbie Burns was not averse to women nor to drink.
Well, I think he really did love women, there's no doubt about that. And I think he liked drink. But people make out that he was a drunkard, somebody that drank a lot. But he couldn't have written as much poetry if he was always drunk. And I think enjoying women, yeah, well, there's a lot of men enjoy women.
An honest man may like a glass, an honest man may like a lass. But mean revenge and manless force, he'll still disdain. Then cry zeal for gospel laws, like some again.
The old kirk in Alloway inspired much of the work of the local hero. Pause for breath here before tackling the final stretch of the journey.
After one drenching, nearly 200 miles and 3 days, I'm almost at the end of the yellow bike road to Glasgow. You don't have to stop here. The National Cycle Route carries on right through the Highlands to Inverness. But I face an equally difficult challenge, getting the bike back in the bag.
There are plenty of stopping off places on the way which make Simon's route manageable for cyclists of any ability. If you're planning to take your bike by train, be prepared to pay. ScotRail sets the charge at £3 unless your cycle can be dismantled like Simon's. For once-in-a-lifetime luxury, the Eisenhower suite at Culzean Castle will cost £300 a night for bed and breakfast. The cheapest double rooms are priced at £150. A less expensive halfway stop is in Newton Stewart at the comfortable Creeb Bridge House, where doubles cost £37.50 per person, and the food is highly recommended. During the winter, the main attraction of the Swiss Alps is going down the mountains on skis. But once the snow has finally melted, climbing up on foot can be equally appealing. The lateness of the thaw means that it's only now that the first wild flowers begin to appear, and the dairy herds can move up to the fresh summer pastures on the slopes. Sophie Campbell packed her walking boots and went to Kandersteg to enjoy the rites of spring. Switzerland is in the heart of Western Europe, and its geography is dominated by the Alps, which cover 65% of the country's area. Sophie travelled to the Bernese Oberland, which lies to the south of the Swiss capital Bern. And rather than making for the better-known resort of Interlaken, she chose Kandersteg in the Kander Valley as her base camp for her alpine adventure. Sophie's first walking companions, like her, were making their one annual ascent.
Springtime comes late in the Swiss Alps, but as soon as the flowers appear in the meadows, it's time for the cows to begin their annual commute to the high pastures. And once they're packed off to summer camp, the farmers can busy themselves making hay in the valleys.
This is Marguerite. She's probably one of the most heavily subsidised cows in Europe. The dairy industry is really important to the Swiss. I mean, where else would you get milk carton tops that are so collectible that a rare specimen goes for £500?
The movement of the cattle up to the higher slopes is a rite of spring, celebrated by decorating them with huge bells. And that's on top of the 75 stone they already weigh. So if they can make it up there, so can I. Much lovelier walking than this. Among the more usual alpine flowers, rare orchids are making an appearance, a good excuse to stop for a second. But if you really can't take the pace, take the cable car and try some armchair mountaineering. The thing about the Swiss is that they're so Swiss. You could almost believe that they all live happily in houses that look like cuckoo clocks. The family-run Victoria Ritter is one of the oldest hotels in Kandersteg, and it has its own set of sacred traditions.
If you thought that stuff you got at home was muesli, you're wrong. This is muesli. They call it Birka muesli, and they soak it all night in milk and yogurt. And it's absolutely brilliant.
Well, it looks like the pictures on the muesli box, but this time, it's the real thing. My objective was this hut. It's one of about 150 mountain refuges in the Swiss Alps, and they're all clearly signposted. You don't need to be a mountain goat or a rock climber to make it, but it can be a bit of a scramble.
Well, that was a four-hour walk, but I'd say it was worth it. Wow.
As soon as you get inside these mountain huts, it's boots off and slippers on, ready for the final ascent, up to your bunk. You don't get five-star treatment, but then you wouldn't expect it for a few quid. And after all that climbing, who needs feather pillows to get a good night's sleep?
The Freundenhut is one of a whole series of alpine huts which are really only known to walkers and climbers. And at 2,500 metres, you've got a glacier on the doorstep. If you can get here, you can stay here.
At this altitude, the weather can close in very quickly. The distant rumble of avalanches is a sobering reminder of the fact that you're on top of a mountain. But in the safety of the hut, sobering thoughts are hardly top of the agenda. These huts can be really spartan, but if you're lucky, you'll get a warm welcome and some great refreshment. It's 6:30 in the morning after really quite a night. Fritz here is playing the Alphorn, and it's lovely waking up here, but you do have to walk down again. But if you don't like walking, there is another way. Paragliding. I suppose it's nice to end on a high note, but quite frankly, in this part of the world, I'd prefer to follow the cow's example and keep my feet firmly on the ground.
God, we're so high up. Yeah.
Switzerland's peak tourist season is for skiing from December through to March, but the clearest weather for walkers is during the short alpine summer from July to September. The only airline flying direct from the UK to Bern is Air Engiadina, whose return fares start at £175. And if you're looking for a complete package, InTravel can offer 1 week at the friendly Victoria Hotel in Kandersteg from £625, including flights and transfers and half board at the hotel. Alpine huts, like the remote Frundenhütte, have no booking system, but walkers who show up are never turned away. A bunk for the night costs £9, cheap, but it is very basic. In contrast to the serenity of the Swiss Alps, we now come to your chance to win a weekend break for two to one of Europe's most exciting cities. Just look closely at the four pictures hanging in our travel show gallery to identify the city by the sea that will be the destination of this week's winner. Last week's winner was Mr. Edward Howcroft from Wakefield, who correctly identified Copenhagen to win a weekend there for two. If you think you know this week's answer, the number to call is 0891 339933. Calls cost 39 pence a minute, and the lines will be open until midnight tonight. We'll have the answer and the chance to win another weekend away on next week's programme. For more information about any of the trips we've featured tonight, please send a large self-addressed envelope with a first-class stamp to Travel Show Essential Guide, PO Box 191, Stockport, SK2 6PN. Enclose a cheque or postal order for £1 made payable to the BBC and mark the envelope with the destination you're interested in. Alternatively, check CFAX page 616. Next week, Lord Healy takes a tour of his home turf in rural Sussex. See you then. Bye-bye.
Reflect upon the past glories and forthcoming excitement of Wimbledon. Live from the All England Lawn Tennis Club with